rules are challenging, but the fees aren't. Now, where do you suppose he'd rent a car? Budgets, where every rental passes 25 quality checks and price is not a handicap. Bob Nickel knows a little French cafe where the food is magnifique, but the bill isn't. Now, where do you suppose he'd rent a car? Budget, where he finds the most luxury Lincolns, over 3,500 locations worldwide at very tasteful prices. The smart money is on budget.
Our copyrighted telecast is produced by authority of the Big East Conference and is intended solely for the private, non-commercial use of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Big East Conference is prohibited. We are set to go back to action. 2.5 minutes in, the Johnnies have not scored. Pitt is up by five. Matthews with a three-pointer. Jones on a follow for the other basket. Inside, foul called as they pack that middle. This is going to go the other way. It'll go against Bobby Martin.
who had gotten position on Antoine Jones with a good finish.
So Singleton has been hampered much of this season by his own knee injuries. We've talked about Darrell Porter's knee injuries, but Billy's had his own problems. His Big East numbers. Billy's season high is only 12 points. He has not produced much offensively.
He's a workman-like player on the board. Very strong inside. He'll get the weak side rebound.
Gets the roll on the foul shot. Two-point Pitt lead. The Panthers scored the first seven. Miller, nice pass. Traffic is stripped away from Martin out of bounds, and the Panthers will keep it.
Sean Miller in deep traffic, somehow able to lay it off very nicely on that play to Bobby Martin. Look at the three red jerseys, the nice dump off, but the good strip by St. John.
And back to live action. Matthews in the lane, has to reset to Sean Miller. Boy, he fired that ball in there. Jones gunned it into Brian Shorter. Couldn't hang on.
Really forced it into traffic.
Here comes Stroling. He's cut off. Tries to use the glass. Comes back to Malik Seeley. So he'll shoot it. Rattled out. Rebound Shorter. Hands to Miller. 14 minutes left first half. Hit by two. Martin bobbled the ball and almost turned it over. Again, trying to force it inside. And Mordan intercepts for St. John.
Both teams are trying to make things happen too quickly. Really a moment where you need to settle down and get a good one.
Here comes Seeley. It'll be an offensive foul on Malik. Number one on Seeley as he attempted to move into the lane. He picks up the foul.
Now let's see the defense this time. It's Antoine Jones. Malik Seeley with the good quick step. Oh, right there. Low is the left shoulder. Good call. Antoine Jones with position.
Pitt has turned it over six times already, and St. John's five. That's uncharacteristic of the Redmen.
Well, it's kind of a frenzy pace, although we're not going up and down in quick shots each time.
Matthews missed and tipped out of bounds by St. John's. Pitt will have it. We'll have David Kane, the sophomore from the Bronx, checking in, along with Darrell Porter. You'll see the brace on Darrell's knee as he checks into the lineup. That left knee that has bothered him all year long. He's had tendonitis. He's not coming in for Jones. Jones thought he was going to go out. But instead, it's Sean Miller who sits down. So Jones playing well, stays off.
Paul Evans keeps a good-sized lineup in there. I think he's concerned about St. John's off the board. Porter will play the point right now.
Porter to the baseline. He has to reverse it now to Darrell Porter. Kane is on him. The two new entrants to the ball game are matched up right now. Pitt leading 7-5. It's Bobby Martin outside. Down the lane he comes. He'll go to the line. Singleton called for his second foul. Bobby not happy because he simply couldn't finish. He took the bump and missed the shot.
Well, the only way the big men seem to get it is outside. A great move outside by Martin. Singleton unable to quite get squarely in front of Bobby Martin that time. As a result, picks up the blocking foul.
Bobby talked about injury problems. Of course, Bobby's had one of his own. You mentioned he wasn't around for the first meeting between these two teams because of that middle finger injury. And he's not wearing any kind of brace or padding at all now. So
and that made a difference inside. St. John's had double figure blocks against Pitt the first time the two teams played. Bobby Martin, of course, at 6'10", does take up quite a bit of size inside.
Strokes both, 4 points for Martin. Pitt leads by four, it's 9-5.
play well in this game for two reasons. That moment, as well as the fact that he wants to see Pitt get back on a better, kind of get better sync, as he calls it. St. Johnson is into the same thing.
Well, we'll talk more about it at halftime, but this is definitely positioning time. You want to be up in that top four, Ronnie, when it comes to the tournament time.
Right. You also want to keep getting the W's because you're starting to notch into the NCAA.
Good feed to Scott. Payne found Shaunell Scott. 16-16. We're tied again.
What happens when you penetrate?
Jones pops out. Miller's three. Yes, his second one of the game. 8 points for Sean Miller.
Good inside-out action by the Panthers.
For his jumper, which rattles but won't go. Darrell Porter hesitates, tries a scoop shot, then follows. That won't go. Shaunell Scott comes up with it. It's 3-on-2 for the Redmen. Kane against Miller. Up. Then tries to dish it off and throws it away. Out of bounds it goes, and Pitt will get it back as Robert Wardan is set to return for St. John. Lucarne Seca's team fell behind 7-0. They're now down by 3 with 7:24 left in the half.
It's happening. Some people are climbing out of their imports and getting into the 1991 Buick Regal sedan. One simple, overwhelming combination. Quality. Buick quality. It's something you might want to get into yourself. Regal from Buick. The new symbol for quality.
Of the week, brought to you by Dunkin' Donuts.
Panthers, who were so effective in three-pointers in the first half, have now missed their last four. Martin went for and got the steal. They got Bobby jams it home. 19-16 is the score at the Fieldhouse right now. Pitt has made 3 three-pointers, the Redmen none, but the Johnnies have stayed in the game at the foul line. There's a good feed as we look back at Shaunell Scott finishing. Great pass once he got the penetration, as you pointed out, Ronnie.
Now, when you get yourself under control, if you're a point guard, the defense comes to you, you read it, and that time, a beautiful feed inside. The last time, David Kane, though, a bit out of control, turned the ball over.
Ahmed Sharif, who had started the last three games, is in for the first time tonight. Both teams are shooting in the low 30s. It's been emotional, but sloppy at times.
Well, the turnovers, everyone playing hard. The defense has been intense.
Foul wrong Buchanan, and they'll send Miller back to the line. Pitt has made all four of its free throws tonight. St. John's has had more chances, but made 9 out of 10. So Louis team staying in it primarily now at the line.
This is the kind of game where if you can gap yourself and all of a sudden start clicking as a unit out there, getting good shots each time, not turning it over, it's the kind of game where you can pull away. If you see the Johnnies, as you mentioned, staying in this one for the strike.
9 first-half points for the redshirt junior from Beaver Falls. Sean Miller, who has, because he sat out last year following the foot surgery, has that other year of eligibility remaining. And he's in double figures at 10.
He loves the three. He doesn't turn the ball over much, Sean Miller. Averaging 5 assists a game and less than 2 turnovers a game.
Wardan wanted to go inside, could not. Finally, he's going to be called for the foul as he whacked Darren Morningstar as he went down the lane. Wardan was trying to shake free, and he kind of backhanded him. And
good sportsmanship by Wardan. Went up to Morningstar, made sure he was okay. He gets by him, but then right there, clears him out, catches him inadvertently in the eye.
That'll get the defender off your back.
Sure will.
21-16. Here comes Miller again. We've seen him do this a lot tonight. He threw it away right through the hands of Chris McNeil and out of bounds. McNeil far.
It seems since the early going, John, that we really haven't said Malik Sealy's name much. He hasn't gotten involved in the offense. He needs to move more, and they need to look for him more.
It'll be a two-shot foul for Werdan because Pitt over that 10 limit. St. John's is right on the edge because they have nine.
Werdan with a huge game the first time these two teams met.
Robert with 3 points here tonight, all from the foul line. Trying to slice the Pitt lead to three.
Nice touch from the line. Pressure by St. John's guards in the backcourt.
One thing is this group of St. John's players, and we're talking about Werdan, Buchanan, Sealy, Singleton, they've been very effective in winning the close games. Sharif, foul line jumper good.
Sharif, nice touch. From Chicago's Martin Luther King High School.
It has been up by as many as eight. Buchanan, working way behind the screen. Turnaround by Sealy is good.
That's a good place to get it to Sealy. Good job by Buchanan. Nice finish by Malik. St. John does a nice job of finding it low. It makes that entry pass very difficult. That's why he's got to swing the ball.
Neal comes out to rescue Sharif, who had given up his dribble. Morningstar, plenty of room. Fans wanting to shoot. He wants to go to the lane. Does, and will go to the line. Nope, he traveled before the foul.
Good up fake, and as he did that, he dragged the pivot foot. What he should have done that time was pass the ball, then cut, see if he could get it going to the basket.
So now a chance for St. John to come into one, possibly tie with a three-pointer.
They'd love to find Sealy again in the block if they could. Here he is.
Sealy's turnaround, bending off, rebound, Morningstar. Good, strong left hand for that rebound. 3-on-2 Pitt. Here's Sharif trying to finish, and he's fouled by Malik Sealy.
Good dish off by Sean Miller that time. Again, if you can control the defensive board, get the quick outlet, and run with the ball. That's what Pitt would like to do. Strong rebound, filling the lanes now. Here's Sean Miller. Nice no-look pass. And Sealy comes across. Good block, but he caught him with the body.
Singleton and Martin have returned to the lineup. Singleton, of course, for St. John. Martin for Pitt. Antoine Jones sits down for the first time, so a respectable first 15 minutes for him.
Oh, yeah, he kept the ball away from Sealy, got the basket in the early going, but he was out there for defense, and he's done a good job.
Sharif to the line. Shooting 74% in Big East play.
Let that first basket to go down. It helps so much, particularly when you're a young ball player, to get the confidence rolling.
It has not missed until now at the foul line. Werdan scoops up the rebound for St. John. So each team has missed just one foul shot. That has been excellent so far. The difference is 4 points. We're nearing the five-minute mark here in the first half. Werdan. Baseline jumper bending off. Singleton on the other side has the weak side rebound, but he cleared out, says Jim Howell.
This kind of tempo right now, though, the half-court set, power the ball inside, play the game, does favor St. John's with the likes of Werdan and Singleton and Sealy down the paint area.
Was able to move McNeil out of the way, but picked up foul number three. He did not stay on the court very long, did Billy Singleton, because Sean Buto has returned. McNeil will go to the line.
Chris McNeil played so well in the first game between these two teams.
Sat out last year for academic reasons. McNeil, of course, with Martin out of the lineup, also picked up some playing time early in the season for Pitt.
Another product of Oak Hill Academy in Virginia, the same place that Brian Shorter went before coming here to Pitt.
The Panthers have worked their lead back to six. Exactly 5 minutes remaining in the half. Buchanan against Miller. Werdan, good inside, outside, and he finishes it off with a tray.
That's a good job by Werdan. One of the best features of Werdan's game is his passing ability. Buchanan with a nice finish.
baseline, draws a crowd, and has it stuffed right back in his face.
I think Judo caught it with the body, though, on the penetration.
It will be on the senior from Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania. He's a senior. Billy Singleton, a senior. Everybody else can come back for St. John. Kane is back and strolling out. 26-23, and this will send a warning star to the line. His first chance tonight. Hit an excellent foul-shooting team, Ronnie. They come in shooting about 75% in Big East play. Those are good numbers.
Those are outstanding numbers. Anything over 70% is very good. Morningstar, a much improved player this year.
Lost some weight from last year.
So I think that helped him a lot. I think he just gets up and down the floor and through the board much more quickly.
One out of two for Morningstar. His only point in the game. Panther lead stands at four. Still in the first half.
For St. John's, two times in a row now, Buchanan and Seeley behind the three-point stripe.
And that's not his space either, Ronnie, because he's shooting only 29%. Miller, finds Morningstar. McNeil. Martin, turnaround off the glass, won't go. Morningstar there to follow. It won't go. Now it's Martin's turn, and a foul is called. The Panthers banging the offensive boards, and they're going to get a chance to go back to the line again. Three fouls on Wardan.
It is a battle inside. A lot of big bodies going at it. Bobby Martin fades away on what should have been a sure two, but Morningstar is right there. Can't get the handle. Martin again, and finally, the reach-in foul. Was it Wardan or was it Buto with the reach-in?
It was Wardan.
Take your pick.
Well, unfortunately for Robert, they picked him. Martin. Rims it in. 7 points for Bobby Martin. He's made all three of his foul shots. He really has a nice shooting touch.
He does. This game has some interesting contrast going. It's a battle, a war in the paint. And both teams have been able to hit a couple of threes.
And the numbers right now is Buchanan's foul line jumper. And he will go to the line. What a great move as he moved right into the lane. Jumped it up in the face of Sharif and will go to the line to try to complete the three.
He's quietly having himself a very nice first half. Look at this body contact right here by Sharif. He's able to get it to go in quietly, Buchanan getting the job done.
And a chance for Jason Buchanan to give his team its first lead of the night. It has been all Pitt. They pulled even at the 8:40 mark after being down by as many as eight. It bends in.
Well, it was like a boxing match. Pitt coming out and throwing haymakers. St. John's has settled things down.
And has taken the lead. 3:39 remaining first half.
To those import owners who said they would drive an American luxury car when they make one good enough, here's one that's much, much more than good enough. Test drive the 1991 Buick Park Avenue and see how good the great American beauty truly is. Park Avenue from Buick, the new symbol for quality in America and beyond.
U.S. Air is offering low fares to warm places this winter. Of course, some restrictions may apply.
Scoreboard shows from this afternoon a tough loss for UConn. They had a chance, but NC in the first half. The Orange been making some noise early on.
Well, the Orange been 21-3, having another outstanding season. Connecticut's Chris Smith had a chance, and so did Scott Correll at the buzzer, but unable to beat NC State today.
St. John's leads by a point here. First time tonight that the Redmen have been ahead.
Martin. Good interior defense by St. John's.
Shorter. Here's the ball to McNeil. A little jump hook bending off. Martin Hannison. A foul called on the rebound. Let's see if Nudo came over the back to pick up the foul.
The battle in low. Sean L. Scott forcing McNeil into a tough shot. Here's Muto climbing over Bobby Martin.
And that will put Martin to the line for two because each team is over that 10 foul penalty. We still have 3:13 to play.
Once you get caught behind your man, you have to be able to box him out. Very difficult to recover on the miss.
Four of Bobby's 8 points have come at the line as he's made 4 out of 5. Miller's made all 4 of his tonight. Redmen have improved offensively in their shooting to over 40%, thanks in great measure to the man with the ball. Jason Buchanan made his last 3 from the field, and he has helped bring St. John's back. They're now down by a point. Seeley picked up by Martin.
He's too quick for Bobby Martin outside, but he'll even up inside.
Worked his way down the lane. Loose ball out of bounds. Touch last by McNeil, and the Redmen will keep it. It's 30-29. You see Brian Mahoney behind Lou Carnesecca.
Like a zone this time by Pitt.
Is fouled. He'll go to the line. You're right. Brian Shorter has not scored a point.
He wanted to get off the snide. Once he got the ball down low, he said, hey, get out of my way. I'm going to the goal.
Foul number 3 on Seeley. So the fouls are starting to pile up. Seeley, Singleton, and Mordan each have 3 in the first half. Matthews with 3 for Pitt. Shorter to the line for the first time.
Putting the ball up more than a couple of times in this half. Credit St. John's inside defense for keeping the ball away from him.
Sergio Luke is about to check into the lineup for the Redmen as Brian Shorter does get on the board. Well, Luke checks in. He's from Spain, a 6'8 freshman. Good shooter from the outside. Give Malik Seeley a break in the last 2 minutes of the first.
strong in this one.
A dozen first half points for Bobby Martin. Antoine Jones checks into the lineup. Donnell Scott will step down as Beckett. Carl Beckett, a sophomore from Brooklyn, is in for the final 45 seconds of the half. 36-31 Pitt. Luke to Kane to Beckett. It's a lineup you haven't seen very often for St. John.
No take charge guy out there. They usually go to Sealy. As a result, the turnover.
Well, the Redmen trying to get by, I think, Ronnie, the final 30 seconds here, go to the locker room.
That's exactly what Louis's doing. Six fouls, Biggie play, of course. And now Pitt with an opportunity to hold the left. Louis saying, hey, get back defensively, bear down once they start to get into their offense.
The Panthers will be very happy to wait for the final 10 seconds. Now they go. McNeil, Jones, Shorter, Sharif, and Porter. It's Porter.
Tight finding
Shorter.
Beautiful penetration and dish by Darrell Porter.
That will do it for the first 20 minutes. Pitt had led by 8. They go to the locker room up by 7.
Well, it's the last shot. Penetration time. Look at Darrell Porter. Came with the gamble and the nice drop-down pass to Brian Shorter. We'll see if Pitt can hold on to some momentum.
That was the only field goal in the first half for Brian Shorter. You talk about key players, a look at Billy Owens after this from your local station.
My grandfather loved the unknown. I want a sure thing. The all-new Oldsmobile Bravada with Smart Track, a new anti-lock braking and all-wheel drive system that automatically sends power to the wheel that needs it. So I'm ready for the unexpected, whether I'm traveling across the river and into the trees.
Or just visiting your old man in the sea.
Bravada, engineered for the unexpected.
See the new generation. Let your good old skies.
Mom, tell the truth. Is everything all right?
Is this where we reverse roles?
I'm serious. I mean, you won't have to sell the house or anything, will you? Well, why would I do that?
Mom, look, when you were away at school, Dad met with Greg Hall down at Payne River.
Well, that was 10 years ago.
They set up this annuity just in case anything happened.
So you have enough?
More than enough every month.
How'd the Payne River guy know back then what Daddy wanted for you?
He asked.
Now through Monday only, Nobody Beats the Wiz is having a presidential sale you'll never forget. Drastic price reductions on hundreds of TVs, VCRs, and camcorders. Savings of 18 to 53% on compact disc players, rack systems, cellular phones, music, movies, and more. Prices have been slashed in every department. Unless you have everything in CDs, cassettes, movies, and grown-up toys, don't miss it. Look for the presidential sale circular in Sunday's paper. Sale ends Monday.
Nobody beats the Wiz. Nobody beats the Wiz.
Working out, you don't want to fill up. So reach for the silver bullet, the one that won't slow you down.
Talking about Coors Light, it's the right beer now.
Mr. Sandman.
Introducing the new Jeep Wrangler Renegade, the most powerful Jeep 4x4 ever made.
See your Tri-State Jeep and Eagle dealer, where you can expect the best.
It's halftime of our St. John's game. Hi, everybody. Bob Page back at the NSG Sports Desk for this update. First of all, elsewhere in the Big East tonight over the Meadowlands, Seton Hall playing Georgetown, and the Pirates are walloping the Hoyas at halftime, 34-26, though that is the biggest lead either team has had in that ballgame. Earlier today, Connecticut dropped a non-conference home tilt at Storrs against North Carolina State. The Wolfpack holding on for a 60-59 victory. Les Robinson and NC State also led by one at halftime, 25-24. But in the second half, UConn fashions a 9-1 run. Chris Smith to Scott Burrell for the layup. Huskies by six. Now Rodney Monroe drives, pulls up, hits the J to tie the game at 58. He had 24 points. Jim Calhoun and the Huskies then blew their chance to win it. Chris Smith misses the wide-open jumper, and Burrell had a wide-open tip also at the buzzer, neither of which dropped. So Connecticut falls to 15-8 on the season. Two other Big East games tonight. Boston College being hammered at home by Syracuse 55-34. BC 1-10 in the conference, while Syracuse has a one-game lead over second-place Georgetown in the Big East standings. And Providence winning at Villanova 30-21, but that one also at halftime. Rutgers, meanwhile, took over the Atlantic 10 lead today with a 74-66 home victory against George Washington at Piscataway. Some other local scores for you. Fordham has now won 14 straight games. The Rams won over Bucknell, 69-63. Fairfield just 2-10 in the MAC coming in. Shocked the Jaspers at Manhattan, 80-67. In the Ivy League tonight, Princeton, 7-0 in the conference, struggling at New Haven against Yale in the second half, while Columbia has a three-point lead over Dartmouth also in the second half. This afternoon out on the island, Hofstra lost by 10 to Towson State, and St. Francis of New York leads Monmouth over in Jersey 27-21 at halftime tonight. In Chicago, pro basketball, Nets are underway against Michael Jordan and the Bulls, and already trailed 27-21. That was late in the opening quarter. Bill Fitch saw Chicago reel off the first 9 points of the game, capped by Jordan's baseline jumper over Theus. The Nets continue to play poor defensively after that. Scottie Pippen drives right past Chris Morris and Mookie Blaylock for the jam. As for the Knicks, they return to action tomorrow afternoon at the Garden against the two-time defending world champion Detroit Pistons. Now the Pistons.
Sports Desk is brought to you by your good old skies.
Hey, look at this. You can get an Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme for under $15,000.
Let me see that. Wow, with a V6 engine, AC, AM/FM stereo.
Wait a second, honey. The Cutlass Sierra is less than $13,000.
Wow, Mom. Olds Cutlass Calais for less than $10,500.
Here, Dad. Happy President's Day.
Thanks, guys.
See the new generation.
Not through Monday only. Nobody Beats the Wiz is having a presidential sale you'll never forget. Drastic price reductions on hundreds of TVs, VCRs, and camcorders. Savings of 18-53% on compact disc players, rack systems, cellular phones, music, movies, and more. Prices have been slashed in every department. Unless you have everything in CDs, cassettes, movies, and grown-up toys, don't miss it. Look for the presidential sale circular in Sunday's paper. Sale ends Monday.
Nobody beats the Wiz. Nobody beats the Wiz.
In hockey tonight at the Coliseum, Pat Flatley has just scored for the Islanders. They are now tied with the Pittsburgh Penguins 2-2 in the second period. Fans upset with yesterday's word that Pat LaFontaine has asked the Isle to trade him in the wake of their contract impasse. But the game tied 1-1 in the second tonight. Two of Pittsburgh's top young stars combined, John Cullen to Mark Greinke, who beats Glenn Healy. Mario Lemieux, speaking of stars, had scored Pittsburgh's first goal of the game. At the Meadowlands, John Cunniff got a tremendous 34-save performance from Chris Terreri. The Devils beat the Flyers 3-2 this afternoon. Ron Hextall not as sharp for Philly. This fluke goal by Zeno Seager early in the third period made it 3-1 for the Devils, who pulled to within 1 point of third-place Philly in the Patrick Division. A glamour matchup at the U.S. Pro Indoor Tennis Championships in Philadelphia this afternoon. 19-year-old Pete Sampras, the defending champion as well as the defending U.S. Open champion, took on one of his tennis heroes. And John McEnroe, 32 years old today, is simply no match for the kid's overpowering strength. Here in the first set, however, McEnroe jumped out to a one-game love lead. When
second half of Big East basketball is brought to you by U.S. Air, with nearly 3,000 daily departures to over 170 cities. By Infiniti, who invites you to test drive their full line of performance luxury automobiles. By Right Guard Sports Stick, antiperspirant and deodorant. Anything less would be uncivilized. By Sharp Electronics Corporation. From sharp minds come sharp products. And by John Hancock Financial Services. Real life, real answers. still halftime at Fitzgerald Fieldhouse. Outside it's very, very cold, and inside it's been a little chilly at times too as well. As we welcome you back, I'm John Sanders along with Ron Perry. Certainly not chilly from the standpoint of action though, as these teams may be over-eager in some areas. We've had a lot of fouls, and we've also had a lot of turnovers. We'll sort that out for you as we go along. With St. John's being able to get back in the ballgame, I think, Ronnie, thanks in part to Jason Buchanan. He had a good first half. He helped bring him back and get him even actually ahead at one point.
Well, he had a good floor game in the first half. He was steady with the basketball. When he had the opening, he was able to deliver from the outside.
And, of course, one of the things that Pitt had to know that they were going to work hard on was defending Malik Seeley.
Well, Antoine Jones gets his first career start tonight, and he did just that. He was denying him the ball, hawking all over. And Malik really had a workout for himself in the first half and finished with 7 points.
And Bobby Martin in the first half with a dozen points. And here's what Pitt wanted to do when they could, Ronnie, and that's run the basketball.
Now get out and run with it, try to take advantage of opportunities. And Bobby Martin had himself a very solid first half himself.
And so did Sean Miller, because he had a couple of three-pointers in double figures in scoring.
Nice job right there of passing the ball outside when you're doubled up inside by Brian Shorter. When you get into a guy like Miller, you know he can deliver. There's a key stat in my mind. Pitt, the advantage on the boards, and that means get out and run with it when you get the defensive boards. But St. John's got to do a better job in that category.
Turnovers, as we mentioned, they abounded. 12 for St. John's, 11 for Pitt. That's well above their average. We had plenty of fouling in the first half, and the team took advantage of that by going to the foul line. The shooting, as we mentioned, was very average at best, 38 and 37. Foul shooting, 13 of 14 for St. John. Pitt made 15 out of 19, so that was definitely a factor at the line. So we've got the final 20 minutes to go. Pitt is up by 7. We're at halftime. Leave.
Werdan and Sealy. Werdan, anyhow. Yeah, that's right. And Sealy playing with the four. They got to show their veteran abilities now to avoid number five this early. Hit with the zone this time. 1-3-1.
There have been, Ronnie, a total of 37 fouls called already. Sealy finds Scott, but he can't make the catch. So important if you're a big guy inside to come up with the ball when it's headed your way.
Yeah, he just didn't have his hands ready. He's a freshman.
Each team has turned it over 13 times. Pitt trying to expand the biggest lead of the game. Here's Jones down the lane, and it is blocked by Werdan.
Beauty. Oh, Werdan blocked a lot of shots with his left hand, and it was a nice shot not to come down and follow it.
Buchanan. Martin had locked Werdan off, so he could not open up inside. Now Werdan gets him, and will go to the line. Foul number two on Brian Shorter. 16:05 remaining in the game.
Shorter with the help again that time. A couple of steps too late getting there.
Right behind the basket is the Pitt mascot, who's wearing a multicolored sweater, Ronnie, which I'm sure is in honor of Lou Conesecchi.
Reminiscent. Some sweaters we've seen. Some different color schemes going on there.
The second one does not go. Martin with a rebound. The second miss. Good stop and go by Miller. But Werdan picks it off to Kane. Scott trails him. Scott has the ball. Scott is fouled.
Oh, what a series of events there. All kinds of contact. Scott Miller had a fine penetration at the other end of the floor. But didn't use the bounce pass. And Sean L. Scott with the over-the-shoulder feed from David Kane. I'm not so sure he didn't plow right into Darrell Porter there for the charge. But in any event, good basket. They call the block.
And with the basket rolling in, as you say, it does count. So a chance for the three-point play by Sean L. Scott. Scott going to the line for the first time in the game. Just a 50% shooter. We have 15:53 remaining.
Runs the floor well. He did a great job that time to stay with that one on the fast break.
Missed his attempt for a three-point play.
Shooting technique, John.
It'll be Darrell Porter's turn. He has not been to the line until tonight, or until this time.
Darrell Porter didn't start tonight. The tendonitis in his left knee, but he looks good when he gets it going up and down the floor and gets that knee loose.
Now we have the timeout with Pitt up by 9. 49-40, 15:38 remaining.
World of convertibles. Rarely has one button done so much. Suddenly, you're sitting in the lap of luxury in
morning facts demands a whole new level of thinking.
Sharp thinking about business.
Sharp thinking led to breakthroughs like the world's first desktop full-color facts, adding new dimensions to the way you'll do business.
Sharp thinking.
It's created a complete line of plain paper facts that produce permanent laser-printed documents of unsurpassed quality. Sharp facts, number one in America. Because the way to meet new business needs with new technology is...
Sharp thinking about business.
Of tonight's game, and during every game televised by the Big East Conference Television Network, we'll select the Infinity Player of the Game. Our selection is part of Infinity's sponsorship of Big East Conference Basketball. Interestingly enough, Ronnie, the guys who were leading the scoring at halftime, Martin and Miller for Pitt, Buchanan for St. John's, have not scored in the second half.
That's kind of tonight. I think we're just going to get efforts from a lot of people.
Abili with 13 points now. He takes the lead scoring wide for the Redmen, who are trying to climb back again. They were down by 11, now 7.
He's got to come up big, as we've said, in the second half for the Johnny.
Shorter from Porter. And he went down to the court. The turnover will give it back to the Redmen. Good job by Scott. Forced turnover number 15.
That was a force by Shorter that time. You won't see that very often.
It's a play they love to run, and they look for number 21. Sometimes it's come off one screen, sometimes a couple of picks. Scott inside, bending off. Shorter the rebound.
Love to bring more Dan up high because he's a great passer to keep over the defense.
The three from Porter.
He does so many things. He leads the team in assists, and he can make the three if left alone.
Back to a 10-point Panther lead. 52
Blue Car in a Second show will have highlights.
Products
will have interesting guests,
like Bill Raftery,
and we'll touch on key issues in college athletics. Plus our usual banter.
So really nothing.
See you during the year on MSG for the Blue Car in a Second show.
Well, all my friends drink. I mean, it's not like we get drunk or anything.
I don't have a problem. You have the problem.
No more drinking.
Stop crying.
I promise it's the last time.
Get off my back.
You've tried everything. Nothing's worked. But there is hope. Get through to us at the National Council on Alcoholism and Drug Dependence, and we'll help you get through to them. Just as we've helped thousands of others. Just don't give up.
What's the matter? Don't you trust me?
John Sanders, along with Ron Perry, biggest lead of the game for Pitt is 13. You know, Ronnie, it's not unusual to see a player get in foul trouble, even in the Big East, but I think it is a bit unusual to see this many of the Redmen in foul trouble with this much time remaining.
Well, it just turned into that kind of game early. In contrast, there has been some shooting from the perimeter. Pitt's done a nice job in the second half of three-point land. But it seemed early in the game, John, that kind of a game was set up, and someone's been fouled every time down the floor in this little group.
If we wanted a blow whistle every time. We've had 50 free throws taken in the game, batted away by McNeil. For Pitt, it's Morningstar, McNeil, Miller, Shorter, and Porter. For the Redmen, it's Buchanan. And now Mullen in the ballgame, Udo Scott, and Malik Cedar.
Plus, John, you've got two teams here tonight that love to jump the ball inside. You've had body bang all night long.
Here's Udo. Off the glass and in.
Udo limped back down the court. He had sprained an ankle about 10 days ago. He's been laboring with it. Actually, it was a little longer than that. He had missed a few games, so he is still working his way back onto the floor for St. John's.
He's doubled his Big East average as three-pointer number three in the second half, and 10 points for Jarrell Porter. He has been a difference for Pitt in the second half.
Call him a spark, a big spark for Paul Evans.
Mullen tried to go inside. Picked off by Pitt. Here comes Porter against Buchanan. Missed the shot. Morningstar cannot follow, and he fouled on the play. Morningstar trying to go for the foul. Reached out with that right hand, but he picks up foul number three.
Another opportunity for the Panthers to take advantage. A bit too much of a lob on that ball by Miller, allowing Buchanan to get back, and you'll see Morningstar with the body foul.
And we are in the bonus, so Seeley will walk to the other end. We'll shoot everything both ways, and one more foul on Pitt, and St. John's will have two. This is a one and one. Everything from now on will be two shots. Seeley has made all five of his free throws. A 16-point ball game for Malik, who's averaging 22 in the Big East. Had a pair of 35-point games, one of them against the Panthers.
He's been outstanding this year.
Second one rattled, but did not drop. 61-49.
Malik Seeley, Eric Murdoch, and Billy Owens certainly have been the outstanding trio in the conference this year.
That foul.
that won't slow you down.
Norwegian Cruise Line. No other cruise line offers such entertainment.
72, Pitt.
On the road, the Infiniti Q45 becomes a living, breathing thing. You feel it work the wind and seize the road. Feel the embrace of leather and luxury. The rarity of a 278 horsepower V8 engine that was born to run. And begin to understand why Road and Track has named it one of the 10 best cars in the world.
In a civilized society, a personal grooming lapse can result in a mortifying loss of station, so it behooves one to emanate the proper air. But with Right Guard Sport Sticks, one gets maximum protection, and with a plethora of ambrosial aromatics, it is virtually impossible to pick up the wrong scent. Well, off to the boxes. Right Guard Sport Sticks.
Anything less would be uncivilized. Academics and intercollegiate athletics are a winning combination on Big East Conference campuses. Gillette and the Big East proudly recognize these individuals. The Big East right guard scholar athlete from Georgetown University, junior Stephen Holman, All-American distance runner and an honors student in English. The Big East soft and dry scholar athlete, St. John's junior Sonia Fitz from Rochester, New York. She'll be defending her Big East indoor shot put title this weekend at Syracuse, and she's an honors student in computer science. This salute by Right Guard Soft and Dry is part of a year-long academic honors program, which includes awarding postgraduate scholarships and naming Big East Scholar Athletes of the Year. One-third of the points in this game have come at the foul line. 53 altogether at the foul line, and a turnover. Back the other way the ball goes. That's turnover number 37 combined between the two teams. That was a good inbound play by Pitt. It was there. The execution, though, was... Kane to Malik Sealy. Big possession for St. John.
this game up.
Well, both of these teams have big games coming up at midweek. Pitt will be at Georgetown. St. John's goes home and takes on Syracuse.
Tough follow-up, Matthew.
Here comes Seeley. Won't go. Singleton keeps it alive. Pump fake up and in.
Nice job by Billy Singleton. St. John's still has a couple of timeouts left.
That foul is going to go on Pitt. And it's on Jason Matthews. That's five on Jason. I think we've had 76 free throws taken in this game, Ronnie.
Amazing.
We'll be digging out the record books, I would imagine, this quarter. Checking for Jones. Kane to the foul line where he's made both of his free throws tonight.
Plus he's away from the ball foul tonight. As many as I've seen today.
Well, remember the first three fouls of the game were those kind of fouls. They were either blocking fouls or at the offensive end of the court. That kind of sets the tone for the evening.
Usually once teams settle into a game, that cuts down, but it just kept going tonight.
Well, then both teams, as you had pointed out, tried to push the ball inside.
St. John needs a steal now. Look for them to pressure.
85-78. Scott is certainly not the man to match up with Darrell Porter. He gets back on Bobby Martin. Seeley has fouled out of the ballgame. Malik with 27 points.
Now
he leaves. And that's the first Big East game that he has fouled out of this year.
He's done everything he could tonight.
He leaves with 1:38 to go following Werdan, who left a minute earlier.
They are playing Steely tough right now. He's had such an incredible season. Now teams are really denying him and playing him tough, but he still came up with his points tonight. He's a tough one.
Darrell Porter only 2 out of 5 from the foul line. The next free throw will be the 80th one of the ball game. That's why it's 10 after. Still got a minute and a half to go. Here's Kane. Trying to find Scott. Not only was he not expecting the pass, he couldn't have reached it if he was.
It was a good idea. It just didn't work out for St. John's. And now it's a matter of Pitt working the clock and making their foul shot.
Darrell Porter slapped away by Scott, but he'll go to the line for a couple more. Chanel Scott picks up his fourth personal foul. Mullen will check back in for the Redmen. A minute, 15 seconds to play. If it stands, St. John's will lose for the sixth time in conference play, and Pitt will move to 7-5. St. John's would be 8-6. Well, that's how stacked, Ronnie, it's getting in the middle of the pack as far as the Big East Conference standings are concerned.
I think that'll all be settled as far as placement for the tournament until the final games are played, John, on the Saturday before the tournament.
Darrell Porter, a great second half. He is our Infinity Player of the Game. He just tossed in point number 15. 4 assists. He also hit the 3 three-pointers and provided the spark, Ronnie, that opened up the lead for Pitt.
He was in the second half. Pitt needed it. The crowd was very involved tonight. But Darrell Porter helped make the difference in this game for Pitt in the second half.
He has 16. Shorter has 14. Miller leads the scoring with 18. Mullen works the baseline. He goes out of bounds. And the Redmen will keep it. Jason Matthews with 10 points in the ballgame. Here is the final.
Ooh, Georgetown came back.
They came back big time to win by 13 at the Meadowlands. Chanel Scott lays it in.
Nice move by Chanel Scott. As you mentioned, going to be a good one.
5 fouls on Chanel Scott.
The other thing that really helped Pitt tonight, John, was your ability to make the three-point shot when St. John took the inside game away.
Miller had a couple of key three-pointers in the first half, and he also had two more in the second half, Ronnie. What we've been seeing all night long is people walking in front of us from one foul line to the other.
That has been the story. A lot of stoppages in play tonight. Part of the game, though, is when you go to the line, even though tonight is unusual, the amount of time, you can see how important it is to make the foul shot to win the game.
Two more at the line for Darrell Porter.
Quite a second half by Darrell.
He had an 18-point second half. He and Miller had
crack a toast to it.
Yeah.
We all do that. When you were 30,
yeah.
You could boast of it.
Yeah.
Now you're 40. Look at that. So make the most of it.
Yeah.
Isn't that clever?
30. Yeah.
U.S. Air is offering low fares to warm places this winter. Of course, some restrictions may apply. One button done so much. Suddenly, you're sitting in the lap of luxury in the new Infiniti M30 convertible. Your foot is on the accelerator of the 3-liter V6 engine, and your head is in the clouds. The new M30 convertible from Infiniti.
Pitt has won, ending a 3-game victory string by St. John's. There were 84 foul shots, 62 fouls in the game, and Pitt went by 11.
Well, that was the